everybody. Thanks for coming. This is the roundtable discussion on history and literature, and we have six writers of historical fiction with us, and we're going to talk about various issues around and about writing fiction about history and about actual events. I will keep the introductions of each writer brief, since you have their extended biographies in your files, but in the order in which we'll be speaking, we have Yargi Tenev of Bulgaria. We have our wonderful hostess, Elizabeth Kosteva. We have, also from Bulgaria, Emil Andreev. We have from the UK, Matthew Neal. Milan Ruskov from Bulgaria, and Vladimir Zarov from Bulgaria. When Vladimir spoke last night, he made the point that in some ways events, historical events, do not truly exist until they are written about. And in a way, and often, historical fiction, in many ways, historical fiction is sometimes redundant in that all fiction tells a story, but it can also be, in some cases, alternative history, when it is describing events that were suppressed or giving voice to those who were silenced. We're going to talk about that. I will open with one question, which is, you are all fiction writers. How did you decide to write historical fiction? What drove your choice, and how did you select your topic and approach? So, Yargi?
Thank you.
Моите книги като за исторически книги, просто в тях има сюжети, които са свързани с миналото и особено с близкото минало.
I rarely think of my own work as historical fiction. It's simply that the plots, the storylines are tied to the past or deal with events from the past.
Много трудно се съсредоточавам да мисля и да говоря сериозни неща, като съм толкова близко до морето, но се опитах да се концентрирам тези вчера.
It's hard for me to be talk about serious deep things when I'm this close to the seaside, but I'll do my best.
Просто си... Наистина, занимавал съм се с няколко теми, които на мене самия са ми били интересни. И осъзнах, че за тях много малко е писано, много малко филми са направени, говоря художествени, и също така дори, че много малко се учи в училище у нас.
So I just happened to be interested in a number of topics, and I realized there was very little written about them. There's very few films made about them. We're talking about, you know, high-quality documentary or artistic films, and then also that little was talked about in. They're not taught in schools as well.
И постепенно, аз като читател правих някои изследване за себе си, рових се, говорих по тези теми с разни хора, които са живи свидетели. И така започва да се натрупва материала за това, което после се превърна в книги.
So I started, just for my own interest, as a reader, I started looking at various sources, digging around, talking to people who are living witnesses to some of these events. And then I gathered a bunch of material, and then that eventually turned into the basis of the book.
Две такива книги са... Едната е Партиен дом, в която става дума за части от моя живот, за прехода на един младеж, който е живял в тоталитарната България и е свидетел на това, което се случва на тъй наречения преход.
So the first, I have two books that would fall in this category. The first is Party Headquarters, which is basically a story of something I've lived through about a young man who experiences the transition from totalitarian communist Bulgaria to the democracy.
И там нямаше нужда за много голямо и проучване, освен по темата за Чернобилската авария.
And that, I didn't really need to do that much research, except for where the Chernobyl disaster was concerned. There I did do
Защото в сърцето на книгата лежи като, може би като метафора, аз не съм критик, нали, за да кажа дали това е метафора, но така или иначе като някакво, като сюжетна точка лежи Чернобилската атомна катастрофа, която беше някакси символичния край на, на цялата Съветска империя. От нея започна да се разпада вече физически нещата.
Actually, the heart of the book, or the metaphor that's kind of at, I'm not a literary critic, so I don't know if you want to call it a metaphor, but there's a, the, what's at the heart of the book is the Chernobyl disaster, because I see it as the symbolic end to the Soviet Empire.
Ну, така или иначе, беше нещо, което не знаех и което, с което се занимавах доста време. Станах някакъв такъв любител специалист по атомни реактори, трябваше да науча как те работят. Включително нещо, което и до сега не е изречено, може би никой от вас не знае, защо точно се е случила катастрофата в Чернобилската атомна електроцентрала. Това е още един въпрос, който е такъв много мъгливо му отговорено.
This was something I hadn't known much about, but I became something of an amateur expert, if you can say that, on the topic of nuclear reactors and especially the Chernobyl reactor. And actually, I think very few people actually know why the reactor melted down. And those are the sorts of things that I was researching.
И това беше, тогава се започнах и за първи път да се срещам с документални източници. Примерно за мен беше много важен един доклад на КГБ, службата за сигурност на Съветския съюз, на самогъща служба, която всъщност дава отговор на въпроса, на който физици, атомни енергетици са отговаряли по различен начин, а КГБ дава, така се каже, реалния отговор. И от тогава започна да изпитвам тази завладяваща опасна наркотична сила на това да четеш документи на държавна сигурност.
This was the first time I'd actually used documentary sources, and one interesting eye-opening source for me was a KGB report on what had actually gone on at the reactor, because I had heard from physicists, from other scientists, but it was actually in that report where the real story came out, and I got addicted to the sort of narcotic effect of reading Secret Service, state security documents.
Това е отговора на въпроса, защото аз, когато се случи Чернобилската авария, не знаех какво се случва. Защо нашите родители си говориха някакви тайни неща по телефоните? Защо една приятелка на майка ми химик се обади да ѝ каже да даде на децата йод върху захар?
So this is my answer to the question. When I was growing up, I lived through the Chernobyl, and when I was a child, I didn't understand. I didn't know what was going on. I didn't understand why my parents were whispering, having secret telephone conversations. I didn't know why one of my mother's colleagues, who was a chemist, called to tell us to give the kids iodine on sugar. I didn't understand any of that when it was happening.
Но някакси се, това беше важно, това е нещо като нещо неясно, нещо, което се случва с такива едни важни години, 13-14 годишен младеж. И ти почва да си го обясняваш. Не съм мислил да пиша книга, когато ми е било интересно, но после това стана като някакъв странен резултат.
So it was an important time in my life. I was about a 13-14 year old young person, and it was something that had remained unclear for me. So when I first started researching this, it was for myself. I wasn't intending to write a book, and the book just sort of came out of that.
Или поне не тази книга.
Or at least I wasn't expecting exactly that, to write that book.
Само с едно изречение, подобно и при последния роман, който съм писал, той излезе преди няколко години, който се казва Господин М.
And it's the same sort of situation with the most recent book that I've written, which came out a couple of years ago, Mr. M.
За мен е неясно защо българският писател и дисидент Георги Марков, за когото мнозина по света знаят най-малкото, защото е жертва на един прочут атентат в Лондон, убит с отровен чадър през 78-ма година, така наречения български чадър.
So this is another unclear incident for me. I started researching about Георги Марков, who most people have heard of. He was a Bulgarian writer and dissident who's most famous for being the victim of an assassination in London with the Bulgarian umbrella. It was a poison umbrella on the Waterloo Bridge in London. He was stabbed and poisoned.
За него веднага всички си спомниха по време на смъртта на Литвиненко преди няколко години.
And when Litvinenko, the ex-Russian agent, was also poisoned a few years ago, then Georgi Markov sort of became talked about again.
Но за нас, българите, това не е важно като някаква криминална или политическа интрига, мен ми се струва, защото това е един много успешен български писател, който се е превърнал в така голям проблем за българското политическо съзнание и тогава и сега. Той е бил по някакъв начин станал враг на властта и са го накарали да замлъкне.
I think for us as Bulgarians, what's most important is not this criminal political story, but the fact that he was a very great writer and an interesting character because he turned into a problem, an enemy of the powers that be at that time during socialism. That's why he's important for the Bulgarian public.
Не толкова години след като свободно може да се говори за всичко и всякакви теми да бъдат отворени, няма нито един филм по този изключително интересен сюжет. Няма книга. Нали, моята е някакъв такъв съвсем бегал опит нещо да направя. Няма... И за мен това е странно, аз го изпитвах като липса. В часовете по история съм сигурен, че не се разказва за него. В часовете по литература, струва ми се за гимназистите, не. А това е един интересен случай. За мен е много интересен. И аз започнах да се интересувам от този случай.
Really confused that after the fall of communism, when we were able to talk about everything freely, why this wasn't an incident, this really interesting incident wasn't discussed. Why was there not a single film made about this this happening? Why isn't he taught about in history, in schools about history or even literature? For me, this was very interesting. My book is maybe a vague attempt to address that.
He's pushing the. Така една година се занимавах с досиетата, които са останали от държавна сигурност, която е разследвала и наблюдава Георги Марков.
So I spent a year studying the dossiers from the secret the state security, which was the communist secret services.
Те са много малко, те са унищожени след неговото убийство, но
most of them related to the case were destroyed after his murder, so there are very few remaining.
Но най-интересното е, че успях да намеря, да се срещна с хора, които го познават, са го познавали, с хора, които са го обичали, с жена, с която има връзка, която има негови писма, написани от неговата ръка. И в един момент започва да се превръщаш в нещо като, как да кажа, търсач, който изведнъж намира малки съкровища, защото държи на това, за което се интересува.
And so I started meeting with people who knew him, people who loved him, with a woman who had a relationship with him, who had handwritten letters from Georgi Markov, and I felt like I was a treasure hunter on the trail of these, in finding these little treasures here and there.
Сега, това може би не съвпада с точната представа за история, може би за някаква по-едра, по-историческа история, нали, както казваме, история, нещо в миналото, но за мен това е история, която ми е важна.
So maybe this doesn't really fit into the confines of historical fiction, and that's not a huge sweeping historical plot that spans time, but for me it's an important story, it's an important historical moment.
Защото тези хора, както и другия герой на тази книга, господин Н, Димитър Пешев, един човек от по-предишно време, те са ходили в този град и аз си давал сметка, че има дървета в парка, които са били посадени и тогава. Значи, по някакъв начин ние обитаваме един и същи град с тях.
So what's interesting for me is that we're living in the same city, Sofia, as these people, and not just Georgi Markov, but some of the other characters from the novel. And you think when you see a tree in the park, that tree was planted and living at the same time that they were in the city. So it's we're inhabiting one in the same city.
Така че това мога да кажа. Мен ме интересува тази история, която се още и в дърветата. В смисъл, все още има свидетели дървета за нея.
I'm interested in the history and the stories that are in the trees. There's still a story to be told there.
Thank you. Elizabeth.
Thank you. And before I speak, I just wanted to introduce a wonderful guest we have with us here today, Christopher Buxton, whom some of you have met already. Is this better? And Christopher is an English writer of historical fiction, and he's divided his time between England.
Turn off yours.
Oh, let me turn this off. Thanks. England and Burgas for about 30 years. So please get a chance to talk with him. Do we know when this is passing?
Yeah, he's more people. I think it's live.
Let's try again. That, maybe that's better. That was very loud. Sorry. So to try to answer Susan's excellent question, for me, writing about history, beginning with in my first novel, was not so much a choice as the result of a lifelong interest and way of looking at things. Since I was a child, I thought of everything around us in terms of history. And probably this was because my parents did the same and encouraged this interest in their children. But for example, for me, it just as a quirk of mind, everything in this room speaks of some kind of history. Up there, the history of coats of arms, the history of Sezopol, the flags outside, the history of design of technology and these new microphones, which are very different from the ones we had last year. The history embedded in every one of us, where someone once said, each of us is an omnibus on which our ancestors ride. So it's partly just a way of seeing the world. When I came to write fiction, I incorporated that. I've written three historical novels. The first one dealt with history in Wallachia, which is now part of Romania, and Bulgaria in the 1480s, 90s, 60s, actually 1460s, 70s, 80s, 90s, the 1950s in the US and in Istanbul and in Bulgaria, and the 1970s in Western Europe and former Yugoslavia. So that the amount of research that book took, the historian, was overwhelming. I don't know why I tried to do it again with this book. But in my second book, The Swan Thieves, I wrote about the history of French Impressionism and spanning 1860s to 80s in Paris and Normandy and the 1990s in the US. And one of the interesting surprises for me with writing my second book was that I ended up doing research on the 1990s, which I remember as if they were yesterday. And so, for example, I needed to make sure my character would have a cell phone. Would he? In a particular year in the 90s? When did that really start? What did it look like? Was it this big? No. So I've come to feel that there's almost no novel that is not in some sense an historical novel. There are a few novels that are set really rigorously in a present moment. You could argue that by the next year they are historical artifacts in themselves. But we also tend, whatever kind of novel we write, we tend to do some historical research for it. I want to share with you a kind of methodology very briefly that has amused me a lot over the years. And it's a family anecdote. I have three children, and they all like to read, and as you know, there's a lot of historical fiction, contemporary historical fiction, in the young adult category in English now. And when my daughter was about 10, we were sitting around at the dinner table, and I was, I'm sure, boring everybody with my day's work. How my research had gone that day, and the book I was working on, and my daughter Yanka said, "I'll tell you how to write historical fiction. It's very simple." And I thought this sounded very entertaining already, so I said, "So how? I'll write this down." And she said, "Well, first you take a period of history or an event that interests you. For example, the American Civil War. Then you make up a problem. Hunger. Then you find a character who has to go through this problem and either find a resolution, I don't think she used the word resolution, or then see how it turns out for them." And this seems to me kind of as good a method as any, actually. I think that one of the questions I hope that we address today is the question of why write fiction about history rather than nonfiction, because that is a very deliberate choice. I'd also like to say very briefly that one of the joys of writing historical fiction for me has been research. And as everyone here knows, research is addictive. Georgi has already expressed that eloquently. It is greatly pleasurable. It is a wonderful form of procrastination from writing. And when I do research for historical fiction, I try to use not only the traditional documentary research, what we used to call library research, documents, primary, secondary, but also a kind of 360-degree research of films, interviewing people if there's a possibility of doing that, traveling to places if possible to see what remains there, examining artifacts. When I wrote The Historian, I cooked a lot of the recipes that appear in the book. There's a lot of, a friend of mine said, there's a lot of food in that book. And there is, and I experimented with those recipes to see what my characters would be tasting. Listening to music, trying to find films made on location. In The Historian, I had the problem of trying to figure out what people wore in Istanbul on the streets in the 1950s. Couldn't find any photographs of this, really. And finally, I found an American Hollywood film that was filmed on location in the late 50s on the streets of Istanbul. And there are just a few quick scenes in the background, but they were enough to show me that people were wearing a very interesting mix of Western business dress and sort of West European fashion and much more traditional Turkish urban dress. So that's all I'd like to cover for right now, but I know this will be a very vigorous discussion, and I'm glad we're having it here in Bulgaria, because I think this is very fertile ground for historical fiction.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Emil.
Здравейте отново и за тези, които цяла сутрин не слушаха, ще се извиня предварително.
Hello to everyone, and for all of you that had listened to me all morning, my apologies.
Ами при мен, да отговоря на въпроса, разбира се, при мен стана като на кино. Любов от пръв поглед и става въпрос за първи ми така роман, който е свързан с недалечната история, но и с далечната история на България. Става въпрос за една църква в Северо-Западна България.
For me, my love of historical fiction happened as in the movies, at first sight. So my first book, it was dealing not so much with a distant history, but with a church in northwestern Bulgaria.
Тя е характерна с това, истинска не е измислена, характерна е с това, че има късна богомилска каменна пластика по нея.
So this is actually a true story. The object really exists. It has late Bogomil. There was a heretical religion. Yeah, dualist religion. The Bogomils, which Vlado Zarov talked about a little bit. They actually have stone carvings on this church.
И това е единствената църква в България, която има такива пластики.
And this is the only church in Bulgaria that has such carvings.
Те са изумителни, толкова са красиви, че българската държава ги е прехвърлила копия в Националния исторически музей.
They're extremely beautiful. They're so beautiful that the Bulgarian government actually has made a replica that's in the National History Museum.
Тази църква е строена в края на 19 век, втората половина, 1872.
This church was built in the second half of the 19th century in 1872.
А богомилството се появява в 10 век, края на 10 век, по времето на цар Петър.
Whereas Bogomilism appeared in the 10th century under Tsar Peter.
Тези два факта бяха очудващи за мен и си зададох въпроса как е възможно да съществува така такива две неща и каква е връзката между тях.
So these two things were sort of astonishing to me, and this made me ask myself the question, how is it that, what's the connection between these two things? How could they possibly be connected?
И само и единствено в това село.
And only in this village, why did it appear only in this village, this connection?
И това ме провокира да започна така изследователска работа.
And this inspired me to start researching.
И всъщност голямата част от написването на книгата мина в изследователската работа, в търсене.
Actually, a large part of writing the book was actually doing the research and searching for the information.
И оказа се, че всъщност аз започнах да пиша книга, която има исторически и философски елементи, тъй като богомилството е свързано и с една особена дуалистична философия.
So it turns out I was starting to write both a historical and a philosophical novel because Bogomilism deals with a special dualistic philosophy.
И така се получи една амалгама от книга за съвременния свят, свързана много тясно с историята и особено с една друга, така отвъд историческа случка на любовта, разбира се.
So it turns out the book has an element of, it's a contemporary book that has a very close ties to history, and then there's also an extra or super historical element, which is the love.
И като аз не съм привърженик на историята, особено на историческия материализъм,
I'm not a fan of history and especially not of historical materialism.
Смятам, че в историята има много срами идиотщини и кръв и пролята.
I think there's a lot of stupidity, historical stupidity, lots of blood and spill.
Yes, revolutions, blood, killing. И мисля, че по-важно за мен като автор е да търся онези неща, които са се случили отвъд историята, които са се случили с обикновените хора и с тяхните най-важни човешки енергии, чувства, които се изпитва.
So for me what's more important is to find those moments of beyond history, things happen with ordinary people outside with their deepest human feelings.
И се попитах дали всъщност тези отношения, тези енергии на хората отвъд историчното, това, което ние знаем като разказ за миналото, дали тези енергии не са всъщност повлияли нещата да се случат такива, каквито са.
So I can ask myself if these relationships, this energy that's outside the story that we know as history, I wonder if these energies didn't influence that story itself, that history.
И кое беше най-странното, което отново завършвам, като на кино ми се случи?
And what was the strangest thing, which again, coming back, it's like in a movie, it happened, the ending was like in a movie.
В така нареченото съдържание, в разказа, в фабулата, аз измислих две букви, които са изсечени на основата на църквата.
I invented this two letters that were cut into the foundations of the church.
И когато повторно отидох в църквата, тя беше обрасна с бръшлян.
And when I went to see the church again, it had been all grown over in ivy.
Отидох и разместих клоните на брашляна и какво беше моето очудване, буквите ги имаше там.
I pushed aside the ivy and you can imagine how astonished I was to see those letters there.
Това не е лъжа, дори да е лъжа, се едно небело веро е време тровато. Но това беше истина, не е лъжа.
This isn't a lie, it was actually the truth.
Не. Това е което ме кара да се занимавам и да включвам историята в моите произведения.
And this is what inspired me to include history in my work.
That is a wonderful story, Emil. Thank you. Now, Matthew.
Like Elizabeth, I've always been fascinated by history ever since I can remember.
Can you speak closer?
Okay. Like Elizabeth, I've always been fascinated by history ever since I can remember. And I think from a very early age, I was fascinated by one question, which I'm still endeavoring to answer, which is, how did the world become like this? I went on to study history at university, and I started writing fiction, but not historical. But after a while, I became intrigued by something I had studied at university, and I think what made me want to write historical fiction, put it simply, was to correct what I felt was a totally hopelessly wrong cliches, perceptions of a different time, a different age. So first of all, this I wanted to write about London in the 1840s, because the perception of Victorian culture is of rather stuffy people in top hats, very respectable and clean and all of this. And the London I discovered was more like a third world city, a complete mess, very smelly, totally chaotic, and run on fairly inhumane lines. So that was the idea I really wanted to look at. Having looked at the inhumanity of Victorian British at home, I then moved on to the much larger subject of the inhumanity of Victorian British elsewhere. And I became interested in what I realized was a subject that nobody seemed to think about. When I grew up, people were making ethics at my school, people were making ethics Spitfires, and we were remembering the Second World War, and the image that we had of our own country was of a kind of heroic victim that had survived against a terrible assault, a brave lone country, valiant in the Second World War, and there really wasn't anything else. When anybody mentioned this strange thing that had just been dissolved called the British Empire, it was like a bad smell had entered the room. Nobody wanted to think about it. It just seemed sort of old. I suddenly thought, well, actually, this empire thing was quite important. And also, it wasn't a heroic little victim island. This was an island that conquered a third of the planet, often in quite brutal and nasty ways. So maybe this should be reassessed. So I then began to try and research it, the subject. And to my surprise, I found that there were almost no contemporary books on the British Empire. The bookshelves were almost empty. So I then thought, well, I'll just research this. I decided to look at the British in Tasmania because this was where they got up to some of their worst things against the Aboriginal people there. And I ended up writing the book. And when I finished the book, something very interesting happened. I went back to the same bookshop where I had gone and seen no books on the shelves. And there were tons of them, all about the British Empire. So I hadn't been alone. Lots of people had the same thought.
Okay. Thank you, Matthew. Vladimir.
Аз вчера говорих много дълго и се страхувам да не ви досаждам, затова се опитам да бъда пределно кратък.
Last night spoke for quite a long time, so I'm afraid of wearing on your nerves, so I'll try and be very brief.
Вчера отговорих на въпроса защо съм написал книгата Лето 1850.
Yesterday I answered the question why had I written the book about the uprising of 1850.
Едно огромно национално събитие, което не е оставило да скотира в националната памет.
A huge national event that left absolutely no trace in the national memory.
Зададох си въпроса защо.
I asked myself why.
И установих, че това е понеже липсва словото, защото тази история не е записана.
Because it was not written about, the word was missing.
Но бих искал да ви кажа как започнах трилогията си, доколкото тя е исторически текст.
But I'd like to tell you how I began my trilogy insofar as it's a historical text.
Моя баща е от Видин.
My father is from Видин.
И аз бях поразен от атмосферата на този град.
And I was sort of inspired by the atmosphere of that city.
Дълбоко, прекрасно провинциална.
It's deeply, wonderfully provincial.
Няма да забравя как бабите пролетно време излизаха и се преброяваха колко са останали.
I'll never forget in the spring how the little old ladies would come out and count who was still with us, who was still alive.
След това цяло лято плетяха, а вечерно време сякаш заплитаха мрака или още по-точно сякаш заплитаха самото време.
They would sit in the evenings and they would knit, and it was like as if they were knitting the darkness itself, but actually they were knitting time itself.
Човешкият пейзаж, хората,
the human landscape, the people,
и разбира се реката.
And of course the river.
Реката, според мен, е една от най-интересните метафори, които съм срещал през живота си.
I think the river is one of the most interesting metaphors I've come across in my life.
Древните са казали, че в една и съща река не може човек да се изкъпе два пъти.
The ancients said that you can't bathe in the same river twice.
И това е вярно.
And that's true.
Реката винаги е същата и всеки миг е различна.
The river is always the same, yet every moment is different.
Но това е човешкият живот. Ние всеки миг сме същите и всеки миг сме различни, променяме се.
Every moment we are the same people, but every moment we're different.
Във Видин имах един чичо, който беше болен от астма.
And an uncle in Vidin who suffered from asthma.
Бив банкер, който изкарваше хляба си, като рисуваше райски птици в една порцеланова фабрика.
He was a former banker who made his living by painting birds in a porcelain factory.
Който беше изключително щастлив, че просто съществува.
He was extremely happy to simply exist.
Ето така започна.
And that's how it began. That's how the trilogy began.
Thank you, Vladimir. Now, Milan.
Okay. I've been asked many times why do you write historical fiction? And it's actually a good question. If you bear in mind the subtle contradiction that lies in the background. So, why don't I write about my contemporaries, about people I see and meet? Why, after all, don't I write about myself, about my own experience? This question poses a false dilemma, but let's pretend for the sake of the argument that the dilemma was correct. That it is an either-or situation. A situation of mutually exclusive choices. That you can write either about history or about the present day. Either about some people of the past or about your contemporaries. Either about someone else's experience or about your own experience. The reason, the main reason that I choose to write historical fiction is that history is much longer than the present day. History, even if we talk about recent history, which is more susceptible to narration, is centuries long, and the present day that you can cover as a penetrating observer of the world, your conscious presence, so to speak, is 20 or 30 years long, 40 years at best. So it's simple enough, 200 is more than 20, and many times more. The quantitative difference becomes a qualitative advantage. History gives you a certain advantage as a storyteller because you can find in history much more powerful and interesting plots and characters than in your own time, in your own conscious experience. There was a slogan of the modernist architecture of the early 20th century. The slogan was, "The less is more." The fact is that the more is more, and the less is less. Less is less than more and more is more than less. History is much more than you. What you can know is much more than what you can experience. Time is much bigger than your lifetime. The past is much more full of interesting plots and characters than anything you can imagine. So even if the dilemma I began with were true, the history would probably win as a better choice. The dilemma was that you can write either about history or about the present, either about some people of the past or about your own experience. The dilemma is false. You can write both about history and about the present, both about some people of the past and your own experience. You should only meet two conditions: to know and to have imagination. And one can bear in mind that what you can know is much more than what you can live through or experience. That's why I write historical fiction.
Thank you, Millen, and thank you, all of you. We're talking then about, in effect, not only the burden that the fiction writer carries of plot and character, but an additional burden of a degree of responsibility that does not exist with a story that is entirely invented. What responsibilities does the historical writer have, and how does that inform her work? Jörgi, you were talking earlier about, in your case, you were talking about the question of writing about and imagining a specific person in Mr. M.
Да, това чувство за отговорност е доста интересно, поне при мен така се получи.
The question of responsibility is very interesting, especially in the case I was working with.
Защото и в пиеси, и в сценарии за театрални текстове, и драматургични, и в няколко книги съществуват хора, които са реални личности, независимо дали имената им са сменени малко или повече.
In the theatrical texts and screenplays that I've written, a lot of characters exist who are actually real individuals, even though their names might have been slightly changed.
Но всъщност то е една двойствена връзка, такъв double bind. В смисъл, те са ми интересни, защото са живи личности, защото някакси не са приключени като случаите и не са затворени от една страна. И от друга страна пък е проблем, че не са приключени и не са затворени. Някакси все още се блуждаят живи, аз трябва да си давам сметка, че а мога ли това, което да застана срещу самите тях евентуално и да защитя срещу това, което правя.
This is kind of a double-edged sword or a double bind, because they're interesting to us precisely because they're open-ended characters. But this is also a problem. Why aren't they closed? Why are they still open-ended? And I hope that if and when I have to face up to them, I'll be able to defend my interpretation.
И смятам, че всъщност чувството за леко притеснение, ако така да вземем като синоним на тази отговорност, е някакъв знак, за че имаме жива връзка с тези персонажи, с това, с което се занимаваш.
I think that sense of slight anxiety, if we want to use that as another word for this sense of responsibility, is a good sign in that it says we have a living connection with the material we're working with, the people we're writing about.
Например, сега когато си мислех за тази среща, се сетих за един много кратък разказ, който всъщност който Грант публикува на английски, и ясно защо беше така избран, защото беше свързан с много актуална политическа тогава тема.
So when I was thinking about this roundtable, I thought about a short story that was published in Granta Online, and it was very clear why it was selected to be published, because it was talking about very topical political situation.
Защото ставаше въпрос, че казва се завръщане в Хага. Това беше по времето, скоро след завършването на, или почти още докато течеше процеса срещу Слободан Милошевич.
It was called Returning to the Hague, and this was actually in a very actual topical theme, because it was right when the trial against Slobodan Milošević was still going on at the Hague.
Но по някакъв начин той се занимава с нещо съвсем различно от този общ тренд. Той разказва или поне се опитва да фантазира някаква любовна история, много странна, не на място, между Милошевич и неговата съпруга в тяхното минало, каквото всеки човек има, независимо дали се е превърнал в политическо чудовище, да речем.
But actually, the story wasn't dealing with the real political situation. It was actually trying to do something quite different. It was about the romantic connection, the love between the character that was the equivalent of Slobodan Milošević and his wife in the past, which is something that all of us experience, whether or not we go on to become political monsters or not.
Но така или иначе аз смених името от Милошевич на Милич, направих някакви други неща, но за всички е ясно за какво става въпрос. Нали? Съд в Хага срещу човек, който живее в резиденция, нали, то трябваше да бъде ясно.
Of course, I changed the name from Milošević to Milić, a few other details, but it remained more than clear, and actually it was specifically meant to remain more than clear that this was a reference to Milošević with the residency and the trial that was going on.
И аз усетих, че имам някаква все пак чувство, наречете го отговорност, или някаква такава емоционално съм ангажиран с това, че това се отнася за един човек, който жив, мъртъв, сега умрял току-що. Тук имам ли аз право на това или нямам право на това?
And despite that, I still felt a sense of responsibility. This person who was living or had just died, I felt a sense of emotional engagement. Do I really have the right even to write about this person in this way?
Това е един вид отговорност, и тя е такава, за мен тя все още не е ясна. Аз не знам дали чувствам се малко неловко пред Милошевич, така да се каже.
And I don't have an answer to this. It's still an open question for me. I feel a little bit awkward in front of Milošević because of this.
Не, че ми е симпатичен или че изобщо съм някой, който е негационист, който оправдава неговите грешки.
I don't find him at least sympathetic. I'm not a revisionist who's trying to rewrite his story, but nevertheless, I feel this sense of responsibility.
Но това е такова едно ваг, такова чувство на неясна такава.
It's a very vague, unclear feeling.
Да. Обаче много ми помогна това, че се занимавам и съм писал сценарии за такива дисциплиниращи, за телевизия, за места, където има продуцент, където може да стане проблем с парите.
But what's really been a good discipline and for me was that I've worked a lot on screenplays for television where there's a food, so it's a question of a lot of money, so this helped me kind of.
И когато там започнах да внимавам много, защото го искаха от мен по правилата на играта, да внимавам за отговорността по закон, не морално. Не им пука морално какво ще каже някой. Не може да съди, умрява, няма значение. Обаче, ако може някой да ни съди, че това е грешно, това е важно.
So this was actually a great learning experience for me, because it was imposed, it wasn't a moral imposition, it was imposed by the law that I had to be very careful and take this responsibility very seriously, so I wouldn't say anything that we could get sued for. It was not a moral question at all, it was a strictly legal question, but it made me really think about what I could say.
И този урок професионален, който човек научава в този бизнес,
so the professional lesson that you get in the television business,
си мисля, че не е лошо да го прилага писателя в своето свободно занимание.
I think it can be applied to a writer's then his freelance work.
Да има някакъв закон на на това. Да отговаря пред... И смятам, че това да можеш да застанеш... Това и ще завърша аз тази книга за българския писател Георги Марков. Все пак в един момент си давам сметка, той има съпругата, вдовицата на този човек е жива, дъщерята на този човек е жива.
It's a good experience for Marco. I'm thinking about my book about Georgi Markov. His wife, his widow, is still alive. His daughter is still alive.
Аз самото... Ако това е цяла книга, свързана с техния живот. Понякога ние мълчим в присъствието на семейството на човек, който скоро е починал.
This is a whole book about their lives. And sometimes we keep silent in the company of someone who's... in the family of someone who's recently died.
А пък тук ти хващаш и пишеш цяла книга 200 страници, 300, за това не е ли... Какво е то? Малко е грубо, може би.
And here I am writing a 200-300 page book about their life. Isn't that a little bit rude or insensitive?
Ну, смятам, че все съм си мислял, нали, че накрая трябва да излеза с някакъв равен резултат, т.е. да бъда спокоен, ако този човек е жив или всеки друг човек, който е вътре, някакси появил се по някакъв начин, да мога да отстоявам пред самия него моето произведение, а не да се държа така, сякаш знам със сигурност, че той никой няма да ми поиска сметка, просто защото е в миналото.
So I feel like even when I'm writing, I always need to imagine or feel like I'm going to be able to defend what I've done in front of that person or in front of someone interested and not just kind of hide behind this idea, well, no one's ever going to come and ask me face to face because they're in the past and it's over and done with.
И тук бих допълнил великолепната метафора на Милен, с риск малко да влезе в противоречие с нея, но да я допълня.
I'd like to extend Milan's metaphor for the risk of contradicting it slightly.
Че тя е вярна, когато той говори за онази част от историята, която не е безопасна за нас.
I think it's true when we talk about that part of history that's not dangerous, not threatening to us.
Онази част от историята, която е безопасна за нас, тя няма много такъв живот по-голям от нашия, който може да живеем от нея, чрез нея. Онази част от историята, която е безопасна за нас, не е източник на този живот, за който Милен говори.
So the history that's not dangerous or threatening to us is not a source of
За това преживяване, за което Милен иска да я използва.
For the experience that Milen wants to use. It's not alive, it's not living.
Elizabeth.
I think as we look at questions of responsibility in historical fiction, there are two kinds of compelling responsibilities. One of them is that I think writing fiction about history is a way to face the despair of history. As Emil said, sadly, there's a lot of human history is bathed in blood. When we hear that 6 million people went to concentration camps, or 40 million people died in a global conflict, or other huge statistics, those things have their own shock power. But when we read a novel about one woman who goes to a labor camp and what her day is like, her week, her month, what becomes of her life afterward if she survives, we have a very different, very intimate experience of human suffering that in some way honors through fiction those real experiences. Dealing with such subjects is a delicate responsibility. Right now there's a trend in the US and in historical novels to include in the front or the back of the novel a note that by the author that explains which aspects of the novel are thoroughly documented history and which aspects are imagined or reimagined or added. And this has come about because of this, the urgent nature of this question of responsibility, and also partly because people are often curious. I want to share very quickly a little anecdote, something that happened to me after I published The Historian. So in The Historian, I cemented my commitment to doing the most accurate historical research I possibly could, using all the sources I could and taking 10 years to do it. And of course, there's always a subjective side to the most committed accuracy in historical fiction. But I tried hard, tried very hard. When after the book was published, I got a 3-page, single-spaced, typed letter from a professor in Scotland. And when you get a 3-page, single-spaced, typed letter about your novel, you immediately know something is probably wrong. So the first page and a half were very generous praise of the novel. He had liked this, he had liked that, he had admired the research about this and about that, and of course I quickly went to the third page, and he said, you remember in your novel, the character Helen makes a phone call in 1954 from Istanbul to Budapest to talk to her aunt, who is a government official there, and she's very careful to speak in kind of, speak in code about what she's doing and why she wants to come to Budapest next. And he said, I am a career expert on the history of technology in the communist East Bloc. And I feel compelled to tell you that she could not have made that phone call. Now, I feel compelled to tell you that that was one of two details in the book I knew I had not corroborated. Two details. I could not find the answer to that. I could not, and I needed it. I thought it might be possible in some situations, and I needed it so badly for my plot that I did it. And somebody retired in Scotland found it. So I think the fact that he took time to write this letter shows how important this question is, actually, this question of accuracy and reality for some readers, not for all. Thanks.
Was that the only such comment on that detail you received, Elizabeth?
That was the only one, but he was the world expert.
Well, obviously, your writing was much more widely disseminated than his, if you couldn't find it. Was that, a quick question, were you doing that research no, The Historian's not that old. There was some access, you did some research on the internet, but what he was writing about was not accessible to you, or had not been disseminated?
And it was not on the internet, it was not in any of the library collections that I perused a lot of hard copy.
Well, I think in this case the responsibility was his, if he felt his research was so crucial.
That's a good question.
Emil, your sense of responsibility of the writer of historical fiction.
Разбира се, отговорността е голяма на автора на всяка форма литературна.
Of course, there's a great responsibility.
Но така, докато слушах, ми хрумна нещо. На кутиите цигари пише пушенето убива. Може би на книгите за бъдеще трябва да пишем словото убива и да си има.
So I was just thinking as we were listening to this conversation how they always have on cigarette, the packs of cigarettes, smoking kills. Maybe we have to have literature kills on the front of a book.
Това разбира се, шега на... Да, словото, човека, който се занимава с слово и с история, трябва да е отговорен, тъй като, както и Елизабет каза за жертвите от концентрационните лагери, те могат да бъдат превърнати в курорти, ако един недобросъвестен историк пише за тях.
So of course, anybody who deals with writing and the word has to be responsible, because as Elizabeth mentioned about concentration camps, they could be turned into resorts if a person who was very unconscionable took that material.
Така че историка трябва да е много внимателен. В края на краищата, както Джозеф Кембъл казва, нашата роля е не да изразяваме егото си и собствените си проблеми, а да създаваме мъдрост, която да помага на хората.
So the literary historian has to be very careful. We can take words from Joseph Campbell, who says that
our role is as writers, as creative writers, as people who write, our role is not to show ourselves, but to create wisdom, and that wisdom will help people through history, through revealing what is happening in history and what might have happened in history, and revealing all the idiocy of human mankind up so far. We can be responsible showing what it was, not to just make it the way we like it. That's it.
Thank you. And now, Matty, your responsibility to the Tasmanians and to the Empire.
Yes. Yes. Well, as you say, I was writing about the Tasmanian Aboriginals, and in part, and I felt a huge sense of responsibility. There are still some descendants from the people. The Aboriginal people of Tasmania, there's about 6,000, but their original languages, there are about 9, have all gone, and their culture as they lived has gone, and their stories have gone. So I suppose I felt that if there was an excuse for me to write what I was writing, it was to try and give them a voice that had vanished. I went through what I could find, which was, of course, records by the people who destroyed them. There was a few very fragmentary vocabularies of their languages, and there were exhaustive and very badly spelt notes by a man called George Augustus Robinson, who was a builder from North London, who went to Tasmania, and he became a protector of the Aboriginal people, but then at a certain point his role changed, because there'd been a kind of very low-level conflict going on between the Aboriginal people and the British settlers, and the British decided that the best solution was for all the Aboriginals to go on an island. So George Augustus Robinson was offered £5 per head of the Aboriginals he could convince to go onto this island, where, of course, they all gradually died of disease. So I used these sources and I tried to produce an account of what happened. I tried to create their voice. And maybe that was an arrogant thing to do, and it was certainly, I'm sure it certainly wasn't their voice that I produced. But I felt it was better to produce something than just to leave it in silence. That's it.
Okay, Milan. I beg your pardon. You're correct. Sorry, I was out of order. Vladimir, responsibility. You talked about this to some extent last night. What do you feel? What responsibilities do you feel?
Отговорността на писателя към историческите факти, според мен, е отговорност към самия текст.
The writer's responsibility to historical facts is also his responsibility to the text.
Ако писателя има отговорност към своя текст, ако има отговорност към това, което пише,
if he feels responsible towards his text, he's responsible towards that which he's writing.
Той трябва да бъде отговорен и към всички исторически факти, които използва.
Then he'll also be responsible towards all the historical facts that he uses in that text.
Милен каза, че миналото е по-голямо от настоящето.
Milen made the statement that the past is bigger than the present.
Но миналото е по-малко от бъдещето.
But the past is smaller than the future.
Затова аз мисля, че всяка историческа книга е повлияна от настоящето.
So I think every historical book is influenced by the present.
Повлияна като философия.
Influence in a philosophical sense.
Като чувствителност.
In terms of its sensitivity.
Като начин на мислене.
In its way of thinking.
Като език.
In its language.
И отправена към бъдещето.
And it's oriented towards the future.
Andrew Mann.
Okay, responsibility of writing history. Well, I suppose the most important responsibility is that to the truth. You should be very careful not to consciously lie about the past under the pressure of contemporary mainstream. And I mean the many various facets of mainstream. Political mainstream, cultural mainstream, literary mainstream. For example, you should not make fools of your characters just to be funny.
Just to?
Be funny. You cannot. You should not make fools of them just to be funny, just for them to look funny.
To look funny.
Yeah. Neither should you make heroes of them just to be in line with the official historical propaganda, which coincides, by the way, with the most popular. This is one of the toughest things that can crush you as a historical writer. That coincidence between the official propaganda and the most popular. Actually, populace likes propaganda. So it's if your version of history is true, but it doesn't coincide with the official version, it may not become popular, so you would lose every kind of support possible. You cannot rest on the official version, and you cannot rest on the popular support. So you will be crushed between them. That's why historical writers sometimes prefer to be in line with the official versions. But you should be loyal to the historical truth in all cases, except for aesthetical ends. Except for aesthetical reasons. You should change somehow the truth if it makes contribution to your aesthetical ends. If it makes the book better. In all the other cases, you should be loyal to the truth.
Okay, one last question very quickly, and some of you have addressed it. When you're writing historical fiction, in many cases, revising the official story. What resources did you draw on? Jorgi, you talked about becoming an expert on Chernobyl and learning the narcotic effect of reading KGB documents.
Всъщност ще отговоря на вашия въпрос, като кажа нещо, за което си мисля от известно време, слушайки Милен.
I'm going to answer your question by saying something I've been thinking about for a while after listening to what Milen said.
Защото съм сигурен, че той няма да каже за това, но неговата книга според мен е много добър пример за нещо. Такова ще отговоря не за себе си, а за него, защото той няма да каже, но ми струва важно.
But I wanted to say something I think is very important, and I think his book is a good example of it, but he himself is probably not going to mention it, so I'll mention it for him.
Мисля, че е важно и за нашите приятели и колеги, които не четат българска литература и може би за първи път се срещат с нея.
I think it's important for our friends and colleagues here that don't read Bulgarian literature and are maybe encountering Bulgarian literature for the first time.
Има едно такова малко, без да искаме, високомерно отношение понякога към историята на средните ни векове и особено на така годините на загубата на нашата държавност по време на османското робство. Има чувство, че хората там, разбира се, са били едни по-малки, по-объркани, по-разбираеми за нас, отколкото после започват да стават, когато стават свободни, да стават някого.
I think we have a sort of arrogant attitude towards the Bulgarian Middle Ages and after Bulgaria became part of the Ottoman Empire. We tend to think that people there were somehow more smaller, less important, somehow more understandable than they become once Bulgaria was free and was its own state again.
Какво може да очакваш от нация, която няма държава, която няма цар или крал, която свещениците и са гърци, а не българи, в църквите и не се говори на нейния език, а на чужд език, заповядват и всъщност отнемат живота като на роби.
That didn't have their own nation, that didn't even have their own church, the priests were speaking Greek, they didn't have their own language. What can we expect from people that were essentially slaves?
Опитите след това да поправим тази очевидна историческа трагедия.
So the attempts later to sort of write that historical tragedy.
В наратива, в разказа, в книгите, в историята, също не беше успешен, защото той роди пък и ни такива изкривени, патетични, не винаги верни, нереалистични героизации.
In trying to write that historical wrong in history itself and then also in books and narratives about this, it went the opposite extreme. We got this heroization of that people.
И ми струва, че сега бавно след така в 21 век вече автори от различни поколения, които за щастие виждаме и тук на тази и Маса, и Владимир Заев, и Милен, и Емил, започва да се става един опит, който напоследък стана много така ярък и видим в последната книга на Милен.
So now we see here, in the 21st century, finally we see authors of different generations. We have Milen Ruskov, Vlad Uzarov, and Emil Andreev that are trying to find a new way of talking about this.
Милен написа една книга, в която едни хора, които сме свикнали да бъдат десетилетия наред представени като герои, героите на революционното ни движение, всъщност бяха видени като почти герои на комикс.
So we see in Milen's most recent book, people that we have been taught in school for decades to think of as national heroes, we see them now almost as like the heroes in a comic book.
С една свобода, с която не сме свикнали да се отнасят към тях.
He treats them with a freedom that we're not used to treating these almost, you know, deified characters with such freedom.
Стигна се до постановка на театрална сцена, която нещата стават още по-страшни, защото човека е тук и говори.
And it's even been turned into a theatrical presentation, which is even more daring and shocking because these heroes are in front of you and they're speaking.
Но като баланс на всичко това, имаше нещо, което много рядко или почти никога не се е появявало в книги, които съдържат тези персонажи.
But we see now we see a balance, something that was almost never seen before in books that included these characters.
В моменти на откровение, в моменти на вътрешна вътрешен монолог или на някакъв разговор в критичен момент.
So revelatory moments or some kind of internal monologues at critical moments.
Милен кара тези герои да изричат висока философия, така сякаш те говорят като герои на немското просвещение.
He puts this sort of very philosophical speech in their mouths as if they're these characters from the German Enlightenment.
И техните откровения са откровения за живота на българина днес.
And those revelations are actually revelations about the lives of Bulgarians today.
И смятам, че са универсални.
And I also think they're universal revelations.
В този, разбирате, тук се получи едно противоречие, като че ли едва ли не някой би казал оскърняване на някаква светиня.
As we have this kind of contradiction, so one people might think this is a blaspheming of something sacred. So the source of this new material is actually the author himself.
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, it's okay. Yes, let us go to questions.
It's not a question. I just wanted to back up what's just been said but very shortly from an English perspective. Somebody who's been reading Bulgarian literature since the 1970s in the original language. What's happening in Bulgaria today, in my view, is very, very exciting. The reassessment of history, which has taken a long time to start after the end of communism, is really taking root. And it's taking root with writers who are really able to evoke character which is real and which is recreating for, if you like, the Bulgarian people, what it was to be living in particular times in Bulgaria.
I just recently was given a review copy of a historical novel where, because I didn't know what it was about before I got it, I was about 20 pages in when I realized it was a historical novel. And it made me think, I mean, it was in a way very refreshing contrast, because I find many historical novels are weighed down with detailed background. And I'm just wondering, you know, you do all this research for your work, and I think you must feel compelled to put it into the book. And sometimes it seems to me that it's done to the detriment, not in any of your work, of course, but it's done to the detriment of the novel. And I'm wondering how you can balance it and keep it out and stick to the core of the story, that, as your daughter wisely put it, and do that, and, you know, have some internal editor.
It's an excellent question. We'd like to field it.
I'll take it. I think this is a really good point, and we've all read historical novels in which you hear the creaking of the machinery or the weight of the research, or you can even almost feel the writer saying, oh, I spent so much time finding out about what that kind of carriage was like in Paris in 1860. I just got to use it now. I remember a wonderful piece of advice I heard once. An instructor of ours at University of Michigan, Peter Ho Davies, had written a novel set in Wales in World War II, and he'd done a lot of research, and he told him an anecdote about how one of his, I think, editors said to him, you know, here you have a description of soldiers from other countries sitting around in an outpost in Wales listening to the radio that's behind the bar and in the local pub, and all this very important news is coming in about D-Day and things that are happening in other parts of Europe, and you go to great lengths to describe the radio. It's this big, and it lights up in the front, and it has knobs, and these are the stations. And this editor said to him, cut all of that, just say radio. And sometimes that is the best decision. Keep the radio.
It's a good one.
Anybody else want to?
I just want to say something as a publisher, as
and as a historian, because I've finished history in university, it was very interesting that Vlado said after Milan's expression that the past is bigger than the contemporaries. And I create and post the law of Ruskov and Zarev that the past is bigger than contemporaries, but the future is bigger than the past. My point is that if we think about the freedom of literature, maybe dystopias and sci-fi and fantasy is the most free point of to write something without any borders. And in opposite, the historical fiction is the most, you know, with most responsibility. But for me, both is literature. And the first is literature and the second is history. And if something not exist, okay, just create. This is my point, and as you know, as a reader and as a publisher, for me, in the first place is the story, the point of literature, the style, the language, the idea, the characters, and after that, other things. The books, like, unfortunately, I don't know the name in English, Jonathan Littell book.
The kindly ones,
okay. I think everybody who read that book knows that all characters and all places and everything in this book is absolutely real. Only one hero, the main character of the book, is fictional. Every other thing, there is a near 10,000 names, toponyms, everything like this is absolutely real. He make a lot of joke. But nobody cares for this. I'm sure that nobody cares what is the name of this place somewhere in Ukraine or Moldavia or Caucasus or something like this.
Except the Scottish scholar.
Yeah, except the Scottish scholar. Absolutely. And because of me, I as a reader again, I want to beg you, just be focused more in literature, not in the historical facts. Okay, it's a good thing, but it's not the most important.
In other words, say hello to history.
Keep the radio.
Yeah, keep the radio.
Okay, I think unhappily we need to wrap up here, but we certainly can continue the conversation. I intend to do so until I get on the plane on Wednesday. So again, thank you to all of our panelists. That was really interesting, fascinating, and thank you all for attending.